Hey Code Crew, last week we talked about the essential technical skills you need to get your first iOS developer job. In this video, I want to talk about something that is arguably even more important, and that is the intangible soft skills or attributes that make you who you are. In my opinion, these soft skills are even more important than the tech skills, because the technical skills, they can be learned. Now, these soft skills that we're going to talk about, if you don't work on them, they may give off the wrong impression to the recruiter, and it may ruin your chances of getting your first iOS developer job. So please pay attention. All right, let's dive in. Okay, so we're going to try something a little bit different, because for these soft skills, I wasn't sure what to put on the screen, and I didn't want you to just watch my talking head as the full screen. So I've put up some coding footage of myself coding, and I'm just going to tell you about these important soft skills. So just pay attention to what I'm saying, and hopefully at least the coding part is interesting. Okay, so first things first, these soft skills are what I look for when I'm interviewing candidates. These things are subjective. I think for every company it could be different, but in my experience and working with people, this is what I value. Okay, so the first one is arguably the most important one. It's not that the other soft skills are unimportant, it's just that for this particular one, if it's missing, I consider the interview done. And that is coachability. And coachability is especially important for someone coming on board as a junior or new developer. To me, being coachable actually means a few things. Number one, it means that the candidate checks their ego in at the door and realizes that everyone has something to learn, even the smartest guys in the room. Nobody knows everything. And not only that, everybody can be wrong at times. Number two, it means that the candidate is receptive to criticism and feedback, because without that, the candidate will not be able to improve their skills. Right? So I'm really looking for an attitude like, I'm here to learn, and there's a lot that I don't know, and there is a lot that I can learn from other people. Being coachable also means that the candidate is able to apply the feedback to their future coding so that they don't make the same mistakes over and over. So obviously this one is kind of hard to gauge in an interview, but however, if the candidate doesn't demonstrate that they are improving by applying the feedback that they're receiving, then that is sort of a red flag, probably something that we should bring up in a performance review or something like that. All right, the next one is teamwork. How well does the candidate work together with the team? Are they difficult to work with? Are they argumentative? Are the conversations that they have with other people constructive? A very easy way to tell this is, are they bringing their teammates up or are they putting them down? So if someone else on the team makes a mistake, are they pointing the finger at them and saying, so-and-so did this and that's why this isn't working, or that's why we couldn't make this deadline? Or are they pitching in, even if it's not their fault, and helping to bail the team out? That's being a team player. You know, if someone doesn't play nice with the team, it can do more harm than good. I don't care how smart you are or how well you can write code. Okay, the third one you've probably heard of before, and that is communication. Now, communication is actually two types. It's verbal and it's written, but it's not about how eloquently you can speak or how well you can write technical documentation or emails, things like that. I mean, that stuff will definitely help being able to convey what you're trying to say in a succinct way without being too verbose and things like that. For me personally, I tend to ramble on, so that's not good. That's something that I need to work on. But communication, what I'm really talking about, for example, if you're stuck on a problem and you're falling behind, do you just sit there and be stuck and don't say anything until your team lead rolls around and asks you, hey, how is that feature going? And you know, it's the deadline, the day you're supposed to deliver it, and you say, well, I was stuck 4 days ago and I couldn't figure it out, and now I'm stuck and it's not done. That's the worst possible thing that you can do. If you over communicate and you just say that you've encountered a roadblock, a setback, some delays, some unexpected errors or issues, and say that, you know, you're working on a fix or you're working on some sort of workaround, things may be delayed, and you raise that early, there are opportunities to get help, right? For example, the team lead may get someone else to help you take a look at it, or they may have suggestions or offer solutions. But if you don't say anything about it, then you're basically failing at this soft skill. So that's just one example of communication. Another example is asking questions when you need to, right? There's a balance. Like, are you asking silly questions that you can find out on your own? Or are you asking valid questions that will shed light and actually prevent you from going down the wrong path, for example, right? So communication is one thing that I look for as well. Fourth one is resourcefulness. Now, some people call this problem solving. I like to call it resourcefulness because it's not just about solving a technical challenge. For example, solving some sort of algorithm challenge. It's not about that. Resourcefulness is more important to me. And that is the candidate's ability to work around issues and problems. Because face it, no matter what level of developer you are always going to encounter unexpected challenges. Now, the key is how you're going to deal with it. And this sort of goes back to what we mentioned about communication. For example, if you hit a roadblock, are you just going to sit there and be stuck? Or are you going to be resourceful and try to find a solution? What I'm looking for is someone, when they hit a roadblock, to try everything that they can think of to find a solution, to get past that roadblock or to solve it. And if that still doesn't work, then I would expect that person to do a research or to ask people, you know, pull on the people that you have to get some help and to get some insight on your problem. And if that doesn't work, then I would expect the candidate to start thinking about alternative solutions or workarounds that may not exactly be what they needed to do, but, you know, it is also a solution, right? Oftentimes, you might get requests from people who aren't technical, and you know, some things cannot be done, or it can be done, but it may introduce fragility, right? It may be a very fragile solution, so maybe not the best thing to do. So you have to keep in mind that there are always multiple solutions to something. You just have to understand sort of the underlying intention of that request or, you know, that feature. So going back to it, I would expect the candidate, if they've exhausted all of their options that they know of, they've pulled on help, they've done research and still nothing, to come up with a list of workarounds and alternative solutions and a list of pros and cons that they know of. And then they can present it to the team lead and they can make a decision on how to go. So that to me is being resourceful. All right, the fifth soft skill that I'm looking for is the ability to manage deadlines. Oftentimes, you won't just have one task with one deadline. You're going to be juggling multiple things with multiple deadlines. Now, don't get me wrong. This is not about trying to finish everything on time, because oftentimes, there just isn't enough hours in the day. It's about setting expectations and communicating. Again, communication, that thing. It's important to be able to prioritize your tasks, right? And to be able to track your deadlines so you don't drop the ball on any of them. And just communicating when things will be done, if things are going to be delayed, if things are going to be done ahead of time, which is rare. And especially with development and coding, unexpected things always come up. And that is expected, right? That is a known thing. But it goes back to communication. You need to communicate and set expectations that there's a potential delay. Now, along with managing deadlines, you also have to learn when to say no. For example, different departments in the company may ask you for different things. And if you don't push back or you don't recognize when your plate is full already and you commit to too many things, you may just end up dropping all the balls, and that is bad. And I know that there is a tendency for beginners to want to prove their worth and to show everyone how hard they can work, but you might just end up burning yourself out, and that doesn't help anyone. So over time, you'll learn when to recognize when your plate is full, and if you take on any more things, your work quality will start to deteriorate, or you will start to miss deadlines. So when you learn to recognize that, you have to push back, because it's worse to commit to something and then drop the ball than it is just to say, no, my plate is full, I'm afraid you're gonna have to find someone else to do that. And trust me, people will respect you more for being able to recognize when your plate is full and saying no. Now, the soft skills we covered today combined with the technical skills that we covered in the last video should give you a fairly good idea of what's to be expected with a newly hired iOS developer. And so those soft skills and technical skills are the things that you can work on if you want to start applying for your first iOS developer job. Between this video and the technical skills video, do you think we missed anything? If you think we did, drop us a comment below and let us know. Also, this type of video isn't the usual thing that we do. We usually create technical coding tutorials. So if you want to see more of this type of video, definitely drop us a comment and let us know, especially if you have some video ideas that you'd like us to cover. All right, thanks for watching. I hope you enjoyed it. I'll see you in the next video.